Thank you, Titus. Good morning, everyone. Could you turn your Bibles to Obadiah, verse 1? You should have my translation of Obadiah open to that verse as well. And if you're on the internet and you want to read along with us that our translation of Obadiah, you can go to our website under the written library. And under Obadiah, you'll see the translation there for the entire book. And so if you could turn to Obadiah, verse 1, both in your Bibles and my translation. And we're going to look at verse Obadiah 16. There's 21 verses in this book, as you know. We'll be looking at verse 16 here this morning, which is connected to the first 15 verses that we've studied thus far in the book of Obadiah. And we'll note in verse 16 that the Holy Spirit, through the prophet Obadiah, states that the nations who attacked Judah will no longer exist. So, as we'll see this morning, this is going to be an encouragement to the Jewish exiles that were in Babylon, exiled to Babylon after the third and final invasion by Nebuchadnezzar of the kingdom of Judah and the destruction of Jerusalem. So we'll be noting that here this morning. And just for those who are hitting our website for the first time or viewing us on, you all right over there? And for the first time, our class schedule is just a little bit overview of our ministry. We're an expository type ministry. That means we go through the different books of the Bible, verse by verse, paragraph by paragraph, book by book. We also do different doctrinal subjects in between books. Right now, on our weekday classes, we're doing 1 John. In our Sunday classes, we're doing Obadiah. And every class is different. Every sermon is different. So in our class schedule is Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday evenings from 7 to 8 p.m. We have a prayer meeting for our internet people who can join us through the website on Thursday evenings after class. We have a Sunday prayer meeting here on Sundays here for our people who are here on Sundays. And usually we have a brunch on Sundays, but we're not having that today. Jody's not feeling well, so if you could keep her in prayer, that'd be very much appreciated. And she's fighting some kind of virus. And usually she puts it on, and we meet in the Thompson home, Titus and Jody Thompson, and we've been here since 2010 when I left Prairie View. So it's a little house church, and that's why we don't have the street address on the website of the church, because we meet in a private home. So if you want the address and you want to come worship with us, you can email us through the website, or you can call us with a number on the website, which actually is my personal number. So we'll give you the directions to the Thompson home if you want to join us sometime. And we have our Sunday morning offering at the end of service each Sunday, so that'll be at the end of service here this morning. And also, if you could, in your songbooks, could you turn to page 191? We're going to do as a congregational song, Word of God Speak, which actually you were hearing through the music before class, which is kind of funny. So you should be at page 191 in your songbooks, and I think that's about it for the announcements. Let's take a moment of silent prayer. As is our custom, we do this to examine ourselves to see if we're in fellowship with God. Confession of sin, according to 1 John 1:9, restores us to fellowship with God. We maintain that fellowship by our obedience to the Word of God. When we're doing that, we're obeying the Holy Spirit, who speaks to us through the scriptures which he's inspired. So if there's anything that's bothering you or disturbing or distracting to you, do what 1 Peter 5:7 says, cast all your anxieties upon the Lord because he cares for you. So with our heads bowed and our eyes closed, let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day that you've given to us. We thank you for everyone that is gathered here in the Thompson home. We thank you for Titus and Jody opening up their home to us 4 days a week and the sacrifices that they and their family make for this to take place. We thank you, Father, for our relationship with you, your Son, and the Holy Spirit, and identifying us with your Son, Jesus Christ, in his death and resurrection, and giving us the victory over sin and Satan. We thank you, Father, for this. We also thank you for giving us the guarantee of a resurrection body and rewards if we're faithful. Help us to live our lives in light of the imminency of our death or the rapture, whichever might come first. And we just pray, Father, that you would continue to motivate us and exhort us to appropriate by faith our victory over sin and Satan by considering ourselves dead to the sin nature and alive to God. Help us to be fervent in our prayer life. Help us to pray for one another and operate in love toward each other. We pray that everyone in this ministry would continue to grow in love toward you and each other. We just pray, Father, for Jody Thompson. We pray for her health and others that are suffering in our ministry with illnesses like Alice Lasasso and Lori Coppersmith and others that I don't know about that might be suffering with different illnesses. We pray, Father, that you would heal them. And we just pray the purpose of their suffering would be accomplished in their lives. And Father, we just also pray for Titus's upcoming trip. We pray give him traveling mercies for this trip and everything goes smoothly and no problems with his travel and give him success in his endeavors at work. And also help Cheyenne in stepping in for him this week with the recordings. We thank you for her stepping in and taking helping us out in that area and serving in that area, Father. We also thank you for this study in Obadiah. We pray that this study in Obadiah this morning, Obadiah 16, will be a blessing to each person listening here this morning. We pray that you would use me mightily as your instrument by the power of the Spirit. Help me to accurately interpret and communicate your full counsel to your people so that they can receive their necessary spiritual nourishment. We pray that each person would be spoken to. And also as a corporate unit, we pray the Spirit would work mightily and powerfully through your children and the audience. We pray that you would help them understand and apply what they're being taught. And we also pray that you would help Titus with the sound, the recordings, the video, the audio. We thank you for his service, the technology, and the people taking advantage of this technology. We also pray that you would help us by the power of the Spirit to sing in the congregational song in a fashion that will be an acceptable form of worship of you and your Son, Jesus Christ. So it is in our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ's name we pray, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Amen. Could you all rise, please? Reminds me of my nephew Andrew right there. Too funny. It's like a flashback. You do, you remind me of him. I'll show you pictures of him.
I'm finding myself. Okay, the last thing I need is to be heard, but to hear what you would say, word of God speak, would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God speak. I'm finding myself in the midst of you. Beyond the music, beyond the noise, all that I need is to be with you. And in the quiet, hear your voice, word of God speak. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest, your holiness. I'm finding myself at loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay.
You may be seated. You see how he rocks when the music's playing? It's really, yeah, you like that one? I do too. All right, you should be at Obadiah chapter 1, verse 1. I'm going to start off reading from the NET Bible, and a little bit later I'll be reading from my translation, the first 16 verses. But first off, we'll start off with the NET Bible's translation of the first. We'll actually read the whole book. It's only 21 verses. And there's a reason why I'm going to do that, as I'll point out to you in a few moments, because it's going to help us understand the interpretation of verse 16 and the first Y-O-U that's in verse 16, and identifying who he's speaking to. Verses 17 through 21 will tip us off as to who he's actually referring to with the first you that's found in verse 16. So you should be at verse 1 of Obadiah 1:1. The vision that Obadiah saw, the Lord God says this concerning Edom. Of course, this is the prophecy about the Edomites. They were descendants of Esau. Esau was the twin brother of Jacob. So, as again we pointed out, Edom was located south in a place called Petra, and there was a high geographical location made them virtually impregnable. Their natural defenses made them virtually impregnable for an army, and of course, God still was able to use the Babylonian armies to destroy them. And Edom, God was upset with them because they took part. And the invasion, Nebuchadnezzar's invasion of Babylon, Nebuchadnezzar's Babylon invaded the southern kingdom of Judah in 605, 597, and 586 BC. The final one ended up in the destruction of the temple, Solomon's temple, and the city of Jerusalem, and the inhabitants of Judah who survived this war were exiled to Babylon for 70 years, and then they returned. So God was upset with them because they were blood relatives for Edom taking part in this invasion. God was very, very angry with them, and so this is why this prophecy was issued concerning them. Then it says, continuing on in verse 1, we have heard a report from the Lord. An envoy was sent among the nations, saying, arise, let us make war against Edom. The Lord says, look, I will make you a weak nation. Speaking of Edom, of course. You'll be greatly despised. Your presumptuous heart has deceived you. You who reside in the safety of the rocky cliffs, whose home is high in the mountains, and you think to yourself, no one can bring me down to the ground. Again, that's a reference to their high geographical location down in a place called Petra, south of Israel. Even if you were to soar high like an eagle, verse 4, even if you were to make your nest among the stars, I can bring you down even from there, says the Lord. If thieves came to rob you during the night, they would steal only as much as they wanted. If grape pickers came to harvest your vineyards, they would leave some behind for the poor. But you will be totally destroyed. How the people of Esau will be thoroughly plundered. Their hidden valuables will be ransacked. All your allies will force you from your homeland. Your treaty partners will deceive you and overpower you. Your trusted friends will set an ambush for you that will take you by surprise. At that time, the Lord says, I will destroy the wise sages of Edom, the advisors from Esau's mountain. Your warriors will be shattered, O Teman. That's a reference to a prominent city in Edom. So that everyone will be destroyed from Esau's mountain. So again, all the prophecies against Edom there are basically fulfilling the principle of retribution, lex talionis, as we saw last week. The punishment of Edom will fit their crimes. Now we're going to have the crimes listed for about which serve as the basis for this judgment. Verse 10, because you violently slaughtered your relatives, the people of Jacob, your shame will cover you, and you will be destroyed forever. You stood aloof while strangers took his army captive, Judah's army captive, and foreigners advanced to his gates, the gates of Judah. When they cast lots over Jerusalem, the capital city of the southern kingdom of Judah, you behaved as though you were in league with them, the Babylonians. You should not have gloated when your relatives suffered calamity. You should not have rejoiced over the people of Judah when they were destroyed. You should not have boasted when they suffered adversity. You should not have entered the city of my people when they experienced distress. You should not have joined in gloating over their misfortune when they suffered distress. You should not have looted their wealth when they endured distress. You should not have stood at the fork in the road to slaughter those trying to escape. You should not have captured their refugees when they suffered adversity. And now here's why. Verse 15, for the day of the Lord is approaching for all the nations, as we pointed out. That's talking about the nations in Obadiah's day that took part in the Babylonian invasion of the southern kingdom of Judah, which led to its destruction. And that would include the nation of Edom. And of course, this is foreshadowing, as we saw last week, what God's going to do to the nations that attack Israel during the 70th week of Daniel, and in particular, the last 3.5 years of the 70th week of Daniel. It's just as you have done. Just as you have done, so it will be done to you, speaking to Edom. You will get exactly what your deeds deserve. Then he says, for just as you, now the you as we'll see this morning, it's a little bit of an interpretive issue we're going to talk about a little bit. The you there is actually going to, as I'll explain to you a little later, referring to the kingdom of the people who are the exiled in Judah to Babylon. So this is written directly to them. So he says, just as we'll see, we'll explain this in a moment. For just as you have drunk on my holy mountain, that's speaking of the kingdom of Judah, Holy Mount being Jerusalem, so all the nations will drink continually. And as we'll see this morning, drinking, we saw this in the past, drinking there is not talking about literal drinking, getting drunk. It's talking about drinking the cup of God's wrath, meaning experiencing his righteous indignation for unrepentant, sinful behavior. For just as you drunk on my holy mountain, Judah, so all the nations will drink continually. They will drink and they will gulp down. They will be as though they had never been. Let's keep reading. Why? Because the final verses, 17 through 21, are going to help us to identify the first you in verse 16, as I pointed out. Verse 17, but on Mount Zion, there'll be a remnant of those who escape, a remnant of Jews. And this verses 17 through 21 is speaking of the future remnant of Israel during the second advent and millennial reign of Christ. But on Mount Zion, there'll be a remnant of those who escape. Excuse me. It'll be a holy place once again. The descendants of Jacob will conquer those who had conquered them. The descendants of Jacob will be a fire, and the descendants of Joseph a flame. This is going to all be, as we'll see in the future, at the second advent of Christ, led by Jesus Christ. This is what the Israel will do. The descendants of Esau will be like stubble. They will burn them up and devour them. There will not be a single survivor of the descendants of Esau. Indeed, the Lord has spoken it. As we'll see in Daniel 11:41, makes clear that Edom will once again be a nation, just like Israel wasn't a nation for 2,000 years until 1948, so the same thing will be for Edom, but they'll be another nation, Edom, during the 70th week of Daniel. Daniel 11:41 makes that clear. So he says, there will not be a single survivor of the descendants of Esau. Indeed, the Lord has spoken it. The people of the Negev will take possession of Esau's mountain, and the people of the Shephelah will take possession of the land of the Philistines. They will also take possession of the territory of Ephraim and the territory of Samaria, and the people of Benjamin will take possession of Gilead. The exiles of this fortress of the people of Israel will take possession of what belongs to the people of Canaan as far as Zarephath, and the exiles of Jerusalem who are in Sepharad will take possession of the towns of the Negev. Those who have been delivered will go up on Mount Zion in order to rule over Esau's mountain. That will be during the millennial reign of Christ. Then, during the millennial reign of Christ, the Lord will reign as king. So there's the book of Obadiah, all 21 verses. And by looking at all 21 verses, we'll be able to interpret verse 16 in its immediate context. When I say immediate context, the verses and paragraphs that are immediately preceding it, and don't miss this, and following it. That's why you hear me say, and anybody who's teaching a particular book, you should, whether you're a teacher, you should definitely do this. And as a layperson, when you would study in a particular book, read all the way through. Read what's you've already done and what's to come. That's why if I was you, I'd be reading Obadiah, what's the final verses to come. It's not like you have that much to go. And when we're doing 1 John, read what's coming in 1 John. We're right now in 1 John chapter 3. Well, what's to come in the following chapters? So you should read that. That way you get the big picture. And then when we go verse by verse, you'll look at the trees and not miss the forest. We need to look at the forest, and then we'll look at the trees. The individual verses, the forest meaning the whole book. So we're going to look at verse 16. The ESV says, "For as you have drunk on my holy mountain, so all the nations shall drink continually. They shall drink and swallow, and shall be as though they have never been." My translation of verse 16, "For just as each and every one of you drank on my holy mountain, so each and every one of these nations will drink continually. Indeed, each and every one of them will certainly drink and will certainly gulp down. Consequently, each of them will certainly enter into the state of being like they never existed." So verse 16 is containing, as we can see, three more prophetic declarations, which were fulfilled in history. The first is a comparative clause, and which asserts that just as each of the people of Judah drank from the cup of God's wrath on God's holy mountain, so each of the nations which attacked them and destroyed them in 586 BC, destroyed them as a national entity, they will continually, the prophet says, drink from this cup of God's wrath. It doesn't say that Judah would drink continually from it, but these nations will. Big difference. The second prophetic declaration, as we see in verse 16, it advances upon the first and asserts that each one of these nations which took part in the Babylonian invasion of Judah in 586 BC would certainly drink from the cup of God's wrath and will certainly gulp it down. The third is a result clause that asserts that each one of these Gentile nations who destroyed Judah in 586 BC as a national entity will certainly enter into the state of being like they never existed. Now, each of these three prophetic declarations present the reason for the previous prophetic declaration at the end of verse 15. What did it say at the end of verse 15? Well, it asserted that just as the Edomites have treated the people of Judah during the Babylonian invasions, so they, the Edomites, will be treated in the exact same manner. In other words, their cruel treatment of the people of Judah during their time of adversity as a nation will return on their own heads. Going back to the principle of lex talionis, or retribution, the punishment will fit the crime. We saw it last week, eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth. All that is about the punishment fitting the crime. So God's saying to Edom, you are going to get the same treatment, cruel, unmerciful treatment as you gave your brothers, your blood relatives, the kingdom of Judah. Now, my holy mountain, that's a reference to Mount Zion, upon which Israel's and later the southern kingdom of Judah was their capital city resided. So Mount Zion, or my holy mountain, is a reference to the kingdom of Judah's capital, and that would be a reference to Jerusalem. Zion was originally the name applied to the hill where the ancient Jebusite city of Jerusalem was located. Before the Jews had Jerusalem and captured it under King David, it was what we call a Jebusite city. King David captured it and made it Israel's capital city. Now, after this city was conquered by David, which was around 1000 BC, he had a tabernacle built, and the Ark of the Covenant was moved there. As a result, Zion was associated with what we call the Temple Mount. You might hear the Temple Mount term, expression, mentioned today in the media from time to time. The Temple Mount area is where the Muslim mosque is, okay? And upon that mosque, archaeologists believe, is Herod's and Solomon's temple. Of course, they're way, way down because Jerusalem, the present Jerusalem, is built on the ruins of the previous ruins of Jerusalem. So we've seen it was destroyed with the Babylonians in 586 BC, Jerusalem was. Then they came back and rebuilt the city. Then Herod in his temple, that city was destroyed by the Romans. So all this present city of Jerusalem is built upon the ruins of of the city of Jerusalem in previous eras in the past. So we see that the on the Temple Mount area is that Muslim mosque today, and archaeologists believe that Herod's Temple and Solomon's Temple are in that area, right in that area. And there's some who dissent, but the consensus is it's in that area. So ultimately, this use of the word Zion was extended to include the entire city of Jerusalem, as well as its inhabitants. So I think Paul in Romans 11, he uses the word Zion as a reference to the city of Jerusalem. So when you see Zion or Mount Zion in Scripture, it's a reference to the Temple Mount area of the city of Jerusalem proper. So therefore, my holy mountain, verse 16, refers to the Temple Mount area as being set apart exclusively for the worship of the God of Israel. Now, the reference to drinking here that we see in verse 16, if you could look at the Net Bible's translation of verse 16, please. Look at verse 16 again. For just as you have drunk on my holy mountain, so all the nations will drink continually. They will drink and they will gulp down. They will be as though they never had been. So the wood is the drinking, the reference to drinking, literal drinking, or is it used in a figurative sense? Well, it's used in a figurative sense here. It's a metaphor for experiencing God's wrath, as I pointed out. This metaphor is found throughout the Old Testament. And it's actually found in the book of Revelation as well, in Revelation chapters 14 and 16, where God speaks of the nations during the tribulation period in Revelation, the book of Revelation 14 and 16, as experiencing his wrath for their unrepentant sinful behavior. So the reference to drinking here in Obadiah 16 is a metaphor for experiencing God's wrath, which refers to his righteous indignation, and it appears in several places in the Old Testament. For instance, it's found in Psalm 60 verse 3, Psalm 75 verse 8, Isaiah 51, 17 and 22, as well as Habakkuk chapter 2, verses 15 and 16. It's also found in the book of Revelation. So it's not just simply Old Testament. It's Revelation 14, 10 and Revelation 16, 19. It's also found in Jeremiah chapter 49, verses 12 and 13, and as well as Jeremiah chapter 25, verses 15 through 29. So I want to take you to those passages in Jeremiah because those passages which speak of the wrath of God in Jeremiah are related to the book of Obadiah and the wrath that God's going to exercise towards these Gentile nations that led by Babylon that attacked the kingdom of Judah in 586 BC. So hold your place in Obadiah. Let's go to Jeremiah chapter 25. Jeremiah chapter 25. Look at Jeremiah. Let's start at verse 1. Jeremiah 25, 1. Jeremiah chapter 25, verse 1. In the fourth year, that Jehoiakim, son of Josiah, was king of Judah, the Lord spoke to Jeremiah, concerning all the people of Judah. That was the same as the first year that Nebuchadnezzar was king of Babylon. So the prophet Jeremiah spoke to all the people of Judah and to all the people who were living in Jerusalem. For the last 23 years, from the 13th year that Josiah, son of Ammon, was ruling in Judah until now, the Lord has been speaking to me. I told you over and over again what he said, but you would not listen. Over and over again, the Lord has sent his servants, the prophets, to you, the southern kingdom of Judah. But you have not listened or paid attention. He said through them, each of you must turn from your wicked ways and stop doing the evil things that you're doing. That's repentance there. If you do, I will allow you to continue to live here in the land that I gave you and your ancestors as a lasting possession. So that's what we call God will relent if we repent. And they didn't want to, so he wouldn't relent. And he gave them over and over, it says. He sent the prophets like Jeremiah to warn these people, and they didn't listen. They heed the warning. So this tells us that God did not desire to judge his people. And he had no joy in that. That's why he kept on sending the prophets. If he really wanted to do it, why did he keep sending the prophets and delaying the judgment? Because he didn't want to do it. But he knew that eventually these people would be stubborn and not listen to the prophets. Verse 6. Do not pay allegiance to other gods and worship and serve them. Do not make me angry by the things that you do. Then I will not cause you any harm. They were breaking that great, the first command, you know, have no gods before me. Verse 7. So now the Lord says, you have not listened to me, but you have made me angry by the things that you have done. Thus you have brought harm on yourselves. When we studied Zephaniah gives us a great description of what he's talking about, which the southern kingdom of Judah was involved in. Because the book of Zephaniah is talks about a great deal in chapter 1, the sins of the southern kingdom of Judah, what they were doing in their idolatry. Verse 8, therefore the Lord who rules over all says, you have not listened to what I said, so I, the Lord, affirm that I will send for all the peoples of the north and my servant King Nebuchadnezzar of Babylon. I will bring them against this land, Judah, and its inhabitants and all the nations that surround it. All around the Mediterranean regions of the world, near Judah, they'll be judged too by God. That's what he's saying. I will utterly destroy this land, its inhabitants, and all the nations that surround it, and make them everlasting ruins. I will make them objects of horror and hissing scorn. I will put an end to the sounds of joy and gladness, to the glad celebration of brides and grooms in these lands. I will put an end to the sound of people grinding meal. I will put an end to lamps shining in their houses. This whole area will become a desolate wasteland, and it did. It was fulfilled in history. These nations will be subject to the king of Babylon for 70 years, and they were. But when the 70 years are over, like I told you earlier, they were exiled to Babylon for 70 years. Then they returned, according to Jeremiah's prophecy. We studied in the book of Daniel. Daniel was reading this prophecy in Daniel 9. Isn't it interesting, by the way we do things here, that you know what I'm talking about? Because we've done these books in the past. Daniel and Zephaniah, we know a lot about this stuff. And so what Jeremiah is saying. So then he says, and verse 12, but when the 70 years are over, I will punish the king of Babylon and his nation for their sins. That was, we saw in Daniel 5, he's talking about who was the guy, who was the king of Belshazzar. That was the king of Babylon. Remember, he got this, that night, the writing was on the wall, and Daniel was brought in to interpret it. That king, that was the king he's talking about, prophesying about. Then he goes on to say in verse 13, I will bring on that land everything that I said I would. I will bring on it everything that is written in this book. I will bring on it everything that Jeremiah has prophesied against all the nations. For many nations and great kings will make slaves of the king of Babylon and his nation too. I will repay them for all they have done. We studied that in the book of Daniel. Who did this? Medo-Persia. They destroyed, they basically assimilated the nation, kingdom of Babylon. They no longer were a national entity as a sovereign national entity. They were now under the command of Medo-Persia. They were incorporated into the Medo-Persian Empire, in other words. So they were no longer what they were. Then it goes on to say, and continuing on in verse 15, where we start hearing about the wrath of God. Verse 15, so the Lord, the God of Israel, spoke to me in a vision. Take this cup from my hand. It is filled with the wine of my wrath. Take it and make the nations to whom I send you drink it. For when they have drunk it, they will stagger to and fro and act insane. For I will send wars sweeping through them. So he's associating being drunk with wine and alcohol, staggering around. You ever see people who are drunk? You go with, you know, some New Year's. You watch, see it on news, or if you're my age, you've seen some things over the years where people are like falling down drunk. We call it. They're beside themselves and they're throwing up, vomiting everywhere. That's what he's talking about. These people are going to be like drunks. They're going to have no clue. They're going to be totally insane. Look at verse 17. He says, I took the cup from the Lord's hand. I made all the nations to whom he sent me drink the wine of his wrath. I made Jerusalem and the cities of Judah and its king and its officials drink it. I did it so Judah would become a ruin. I did so. Judah, its kings and its officials would become an object of horror and of hissing scorn, an example used in curses. Such is already becoming the case. I made all of these other people drink it. Pharaoh, king of Egypt, his attendants, his officials, his people, the foreigners living in Egypt, all the kings of the land of Uz, all the kings of the land of the Philistines, the people of Ashkelon, Gaza, Ekron, the people who had been left alive from Ashdod, all those nations that we just read there, we saw in Zephaniah. All the Zephaniah, we see that Jeremiah and Obadiah were contemporaries. Okay? Obadiah's prophecy came after Jeremiah's, and it echoes Jeremiah 49's prophecy of Edom. And Zephaniah, he wrote his prophecy prior to the destruction of the southern kingdom of Judah, as we pointed out. Verse 21, all the people of Edom, Moab, Ammon, and all the kings of Tyre, they're all going to drink the cup of God's wrath. All the kings of Sidon, all the kings of the coastlands along the sea, the people of Dedan, Tema, Buzz, all the desert people who cut their hair short at the temples, all the kings of Arabia who live in the desert, all Babylon's going to, led by Nebuchadnezzar, is going to conquer all these nations. All the kings of Zimri, all the kings of Elam, all the kings of Media, all the kings of the north, whether near or far from one another, and all the other kingdoms which are on the face of the earth, after all of them have drunk the wine of the Lord's wrath, the king of Babylon must drink it. Then the Lord said to me, tell them that the Lord God of Israel, who rules over all, he's sovereign, says, drink this cup until you get drunk and vomit. Drink until you fall down and can't get up. For I will send wars sweeping through you. If they refuse to take the cup of your hand and drink it, tell them that the Lord who rules over all says, you most certainly must drink it. For take note, I am already beginning to bring disaster on the city that I call my own, Jerusalem. So how can you possibly avoid being punished? You will not go unpunished, for I am proclaiming war against all who live on the earth. I, the Lord, who rules over all, affirm it. So we see God using Nebuchadnezzar, a pagan king at that time, an evil pagan king, idolater, going, and a despicable man, a merciless person, going to be used as God's instrument of judgment against these nations, including the southern kingdom of Judah. And why? For their unrepentant, sinful behavior. Generations went on, and finally God said, that's it. God's patient, but he's not everlasting patience. So they wouldn't repent, so now he's not going to relent. So we see the cup of God's wrath mentioned by Jeremiah, who's a contemporary of Obadiah, with Obadiah's prophecy coming sometime after this prophecy, many, many years probably after, but in the 6th century B.C. Go back now to Obadiah, verse 16. Now, the first prophetic declaration in verse 16 indicates, of Obadiah 16, indicates that the Edomites should have never cruelly mistreated the people of Judah during the Babylonian invasion of 586 BC, because now they, along with all the nations involved, will have to drink continually from God's cup of wrath. It is comparing the people of Judah experiencing God's wrath during the Babylonian invasions of 586 BC with the nations who took part in this invasion against them experiencing God's wrath themselves continually. Now, we come to a little bit of an interpretive issue, trying to identify who the you is in verse 16. The second person, what we see is the second person plural form of the verb in the Hebrew shatah, I think is the word there. If I may look at it here, where is it? Yeah, shatah. And this word shatah, my Hebrew text is a little small there. The second person plural form of the verb, I'm like, what is it? But second person plural form of the verb shatah, you have drunk, which appears in the first prophetic declaration, refers to the Jewish exiles in Babylon, and it's used in a distributive sense, emphasizing no exceptions. Each of these exiles experienced God's wrath during the Babylonian invasion, as evidenced by the fact that they're now living in Babylon rather than the land of promise. So I'm interpreting this particular phrase, and if you look at the Net Bible, for just as you have drunk, you, Y-O-U. Now, that looks like it's in the singular form in English. It's in the second person plural form. And that's very important because prior to that, we didn't have that. We had a singular form in the previous verses. Like, for instance, in verse 15, if I could just wait for my logos to go. Good. When I need it to go quick, it doesn't do that. But there's a second person singular form. Here it is. In verse 15, there's the word "you" is found. It's in the singular form. It's a second person singular, masculine singular form. So they translate it "you." But when you get to verse 16, there's a second person plural form, not a singular form. And that would catch the reader and the person who heard this prophecy, it would catch their attention. It's saying a significant shift has taken place as to who he's addressing. So because of this, a lot of interpreters of this book have had trouble with this. So there's three, I like to do this. There's three interpretations of this particular you. In the first you, in verse 16, who's it referring to? So there's three possible interpretations. So if you could be patient with me, I'll take the next 5 minutes to describe, explain this. And the reason why I do this is because I know a lot of people, when they come to Bible class, they don't like to think. They just like to sit there in a moat or something. I don't know what. But when you come to Bible class, you know, you're supposed to love God with all your mind strength, you know, your entire being, your heart, soul, mind, strength. You're thinking. So I'm not going to just sit there and go, this is what it is. If there's other interpretation, and this is a big issue here, interpreting verse 16 and helping us to understand who he's talking about here, who he's addressing. So I'm going to give you other possible interpretations, two others that are different than mine. So a lot of people agree with mine, and there's some that dissent. So I'm going to bring these out, and I'll let you decide which is the proper one. So the first interpretation, there's three options. The first is that the second person plural form of this verb is referring to the nation of Edom, who is the subject of the prophecies in verses 1 through 15. That makes sense, right? That you would think that, okay, why is the you any different in verse 16 than the previous ones? Well, again, it's a different form. It's a second person plural form, not a singular form. The yous in the first 15 verses were in a singular form. So that's, some people say, well, it's still talking about Edom. Now, the problem with this interpretation is that the second person singular form of verbs have been used thus far in Obadiah when the prophet has been referring to Edom. The plural form of this verb, shatah, you have drunk in verse 16, would indicate that Edom is not in view. Or in other words, it's not referring to at least her alone, at the least. There's a possibility that both Edom and the nations are being addressed here with the second person plural form of this verb. However, the nations are referred to in the third person in verse 16. Thus, it's unlikely that the you have drunk in verse 16, the first one, is not referring to Edom and all these nations. It can't, because all these nations are referred to in the third person singular form in verse 16. So there's something has changed. Here's another view. There's another view that the Net Bible brings out. And they have another option. And I'm quoting from them. They say another option is to take the final mem, that's a Hebrew letter, on the Hebrew verb form of shatah as an enclitic particle and revocalize the form as a singular verb addressed to Edom. This would then be alluding to the time when Edom celebrated Jerusalem's feasts on Mount Zion, God's holy hill. They go on to say, verse 16b would then make the ironic point that just as Edom once drank in victory, so the nations, Edom included, would someday drink the cup of judgment. However, they say, and I'm in agreement with them, this interpretation is problematic, for it necessitates taking the drinking metaphor in different ways, such as signifying celebration and then judgment, within the same verse, end of quote. And that's unlikely that the writer is going to be doing that. Now, the third view, which is my view, is that the people of Judah, who survived the Babylonian invasions of 586 BC and were exiled to Babylon, are being addressed here by the second person plural form of this verb, shatah, which the Net Bible and most English all the English translations are not going to differentiation in their translation like I do. Because I do make it, if you look at my translation of verse 16, you can see clearly, look at verse 15 first, and then look at verse 16, I make the distinction for you, so you see what the original audience would have saw. Look at verse 15. For the period of judgment to be brought about by the Lord against each and every one of the nations is imminent. Just as you, it's in the singular form in the Hebrew, have done, so it will be done in the same manner to you, singular. Your actions will return on your own head. Verse 16, for just as each and every one of you drank on my holy mountain, so each and every one of these nations will drink continually. So notice as each and every one of you drunk on my holy mountain. So it's not just you singular, it's each and every one of you. There's more than one person involved. You see that in my translation? The English translations don't do that. And that causes a problem for interpreting this particular verse when you do that. So let's keep going on with my explanation here. So we see that therefore the prophet would be addressing these Jewish exiles in Babylon here in verse 16, and he would be thus giving them encouragement. So when he says, just as you, each and every one of you, all of you, you Jewish exiles in Babylon, have drunk of the cup of my wrath in 586 BC, so all these other nations will drink from it continually. You didn't drink from it continually, but they will. That means that they will no longer exist as national entities. I'm only putting you in Babylon for 70 years. Jeremiah says that. We just read that. I'm bringing you back. So God doesn't say that they had drunk continually from this cup of wrath, only these other nations that attacked them and destroyed them. So, however, there's some people argue, and I want to bring out those who dissent with my view, which is a view of many guys. I'm not the only person. Some argue that this interpretation of mine and others is problematic because these Jewish exiles in Babylon are never addressed elsewhere in the prophecy of Obadiah. Really? Though it is true that the Jewish exiles have not been addressed in the first 15 verses of the prophecy of Obadiah, the prophetic declarations in verses 17 through 21 are all related to the future of the believing remnant of Israel. In other words, verses 17 through 21, which I had you read with me earlier, contain prophetic declarations which would be of great interest and encouragement for the Jewish exiles in Babylon because they're all related to the glorious future for the believing remnant of Israel. So that's why I had you read verses 17 through 21, because all those verses are about the future remnant of Israel. Why would that be encouraging and a great comfort to the Jewish exiles, the believing remnant in Babylon? Of course it would be. It says God has a future for the nation of Israel. He has a future for the nation of Israel. Those people are actually the people that the millennial kingdom that's predicted in those verses of Obadiah, the final several verses. Those people in Babylon who are the believing remnant are going to come back to the land of Israel and rebuild it. They're going to be a part of that millennial kingdom in resurrection bodies. Of course, it would be an encouragement to them. So the people who say my interpretation, or I should say our interpretation of the first you have drunk on my holy mountain, verse 16. The problem with that, they say, is that the kingdom of Judah has not been spoken to at all in this prophecy in the first 15 verses. Well, the future remnant of Israel is being referred to and prophesied about in verses 17 through 21. So that their argument is really unfounded, because you got to read that the context is not just what has gone before, but what comes after. A lot of people make a mistake. I've known pastors, and I've done it in the past, not as much in a long, it's been a while since I've done it, thank God, but because I watch it. I've known some guys that they're teaching, and then they get caught, and they didn't read the whole thing all the way through, the book, amazingly, and their interpretation is skewed because rejected because of what goes on later in the book, like especially at the book of Romans. You know, so you gotta pay attention to what comes immediately before, what comes after, and also in the whole book, you gotta pay attention. So, furthermore, this third interpretation allows one to keep the drinking metaphor in all three lines in verse 16, parallel with each line describing God's wrath. Consequently, the comparison being made here in verse 16 is between the people of Judah and Jerusalem experiencing God's wrath and all the nations who took part in their demise in 586 BC experiencing this wrath as well. However, Judah experienced this wrath temporarily, but these nations, as we pointed out, will experience it continually. So therefore, I am of the view that the second person plural form of this verb, shata, you have drunk, in verse 16, indicates that the prophetic declarations in this verse are the beginning of a series of prophetic declarations which end in verse 21, which are the benefit for the Jewish people in Babylon, the exiles. So what he's saying in verse 16 is an encouragement to them. What he says about what's going to happen in the future with the Jews, is it going to be an encouragement to these people sitting in Babylon? God gives encouragement. God is a God of encouragement. He is. And where do we get our encouragement? From the scriptures. And this is going to be a, this message to the Jewish exiles in Babylon would be a great encouragement. You and I should. This tells us of God's faithfulness. God's going to keep bring the Jews back to the land. He has a great future for the Jews because he has promises called the unconditional promises to Israel, the four of them: Abrahamic, Davidic, Palestinian, and New Covenant. They guarantee that the Jews will always exist. In fact, they guarantee that national regeneration and restoration of the Jewish people. They're going to be regenerated at the second advent of Jesus Christ. They'll look upon whom they pierced, Zechariah 14, and they'll weep for him as a firstborn son. When you lose a firstborn son, they'll weep like that over Jesus Christ when he comes back to deliver them from the tribulational armies and Antichrist and Satan. And also, they'll be restored to the land. They have never even occupied 1/30th of the land that they're supposed to occupy. But during the millennial reign of Christ, as we'll see in verses 17 through 21 of Obadiah, they will. All that occupy, the verses 19 through 21 of Obadiah are all talking about Israel receiving finally the promises contained in the Abrahamic and Palestinian covenant. And all of them are unconditional promises, because that means that it's not the fulfillment of these covenants are not dependent upon the faithfulness of the Jews like the Mosaic covenant was, which is a conditional covenant. No, it's dependent upon the faithfulness of God. So one generation of Jews might fail, but God has always set aside a remnant of believing Jews in every dispensation of history. He's done it now. They're a part of the church, the Jews. They call Messianic Jews. They're around today. Okay? I know some Messianic Jews. And so those people are a part of the believing remnant of Israel. And they're found in the church in our day and age, in the church age. So let's continue on. Thank you for being patient with me. So we see that, as we noted, the second prophetic declaration in verse 16. Let's look at verse 16 again in my translation. Verse 16, for just as each and every one of you, exiles of Judah in Babylon, drank of my holy mountain in Jerusalem, so each and every one of these nations will drink continually. Indeed, each and every one of them will certainly drink and will certainly gulp down. Consequently, each one of them will certainly enter into the state of being like they never existed. So as we noted, the second prophetic declaration in verse 16 advances upon and intensifies the first. That's indicated by the addition of the third person masculine plural, calactive perfect form of the verb la'a, swallow, to the third person masculine plural calactive perfect form of the verb shata, they shall drink. The latter did not appear with the third person form of the word for swallow in the Greek, the Hebrew, in the previous prophetic declaration. Now, the purpose of this advancement and intensification is to emphasize with the Jewish exiles in Babylon God's resolve to judge these Gentile nations that attack them. Let me show you what I mean. If you look at my translation again, it says in verse 16, for just as each and every one of you drank on my holy mountain, you Jewish exiles in Babylon, so each one of these nations will drink continually, the ones that attacked you. That means continually means they're no longer they're going to drink it to an extent that they're no longer going to exist as a national entity. Then here's the advancement upon that. Indeed, each and every one of them will certainly drink, note the certainly there, and will certainly, note the certainly, gulp down. That means, that's telling us God's, is determined, his determination to judge every one of these Gentile nations that attack the kingdom of Judah. So in other words, he's telling the Jewish exiles in Babylon that they experienced God's wrath temporarily, but these Gentile nations who were used by God to destroy them as a national entity will endure continual punishment. The result clause at the end of verse 16, in my translation it begins with the word consequently, indicates that this continual punishment is a reference to the fact that they will no longer exist as national entities, just as Judah temporarily for 70 years did not exist as a national entity. Now, the third prophetic declaration presents the result of the second one and indicates that these nations, which took part in the destruction of Judah, will experience God's wrath continually, with the result that they will no longer exist as national entities. These prophetic declarations in verse 16 were fulfilled in history, people, because none of these nations who destroyed Judah in 586 BC exist anymore. Pointed out that in the past. It's been fulfilled in history. What is that telling you about God's word? God's word is power. God, listen to me, I'd like to bring this out. The application for you and I, you're sitting there probably saying, man, okay, God's power, God's word is powerful, but this is about nations. All right, if God rules the world, I studied this in Daniel. If God rules the world with his word, does he not? He tells of his intentions to raise up nations and destroy them. And he does it with his word, through the prophets. If he does that, can he govern our lives with his word? Our little old lives, when he can govern his nations and kings, he can. His word can certainly govern our lives. We can trust in his word. You don't need a pill. You don't need a psychologist or a psychology. You don't need somebody to sit there and, you know, you need God's word and you need God's people who have God's word and godly view. That's what you need in life. That's what I need in life. We need the word of God. Man does not live on bread alone, but from every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God, people. Do we believe that? I believe it. I can't have that conviction. I know many of you do. But some people don't have that conviction in the body of Christ. And it's evidenced by the fact that when you come to churches, are they emphasizing the teaching of the word of God? No. How many churches teach for an hour? Heck, I go over, if you notice, I go hour, 10 minutes sometimes. Ooh, I used to get grief in the other place because I would 10 minutes later. I get in the deacon's meeting. I get run up and down on it. And I'd go, okay, sorry about that, you know. And the next time I'd do 10 minutes longer. I'd go to 10 minutes again. It's like, are you kidding me? I said, well, just if you have to go somewhere, go somewhere. But really, where do you have to go on a Sunday morning? Go to work. Well, then go to work. Go to work if you have to go at that time. But I'm not gonna stop. I'm going to finish the message that God has me to teach. And if you don't like it, that's too bad. I mean, really. It's not that I don't respect people's time. I do respect people's time. I don't think the people in the body of Christ, many of them, I know in this place we don't have that problem, but many in the body of Christ don't have respect for God's word. They want respect for their time, but God gave you that time. So let me tell you what's more important. You get 10 minutes, an hour and 10 minutes, or an hour and minute of hearing God, you're on his time. You're in God's time. Like, for instance, you go to your work, and your boss, you're on his time. You're on his time. So God, who's the sovereign, okay, he's the top boss, right? We're on his time. So to sit there and say, oh, God, I have to have an hour of the Bible class. Oh, 4 days a week? Oh, or Sunday. Some people, they don't even want to go anywhere. I got people, I know Christians in my building, and they don't go anywhere. It's like, where are you getting fed? Where are you getting encouraged? And, I mean, you might as well, you're just like the people of the world. Come to a class on Sunday. Whatever you can do, go. And if you can't be here during the weekday classes, then go listen to download the classes online if you can. You know, but get the word of God. I mean, I'm thankful for the people who show up and on Sundays and during our weekday classes. You need God's word. That's what you need. That's going to help you in your marriage. That's going to help you in dealing with relationships. Listen to me. This is going to help you in dealing with your own problems. We all have problems. We all have difficulties. We all have anxieties. We all do. Every one of us. We're all human sinners. We need God's word. Man does not live on bread alone, but from every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. It wasn't until I got it seriously into the word of God that a lot of the garbage I have had to deal with in my life started to clean it out with his word. I got rid of the silly things I was thinking about, silly priorities I had, and I thank God I made that decision as a young man. I didn't waste my whole adult life with stupid things and filling my head with stupid things. You put stupid things in your head, stupid things are going to come out. You put good things in your head, God's word, good things are going to come out. It's just like a computer. Garbage in, garbage out. Okay? So we've got to make a decision that Am I going to devote, to be committed to the God's word? What am I going to do? What, am I going to do that? Or am I going to be like everybody else in this planet who has no clue what's going on? When disaster happens, they don't know how to handle it. I told you the story, 911 happened. I'm there one month in Iowa and 911 happens. Everybody, we had a prayer meeting. We had a weekly prayer meeting. A few people would show up. This is at the beginning of the ministry. On 911, I walk in. The place is jammed. I was like, wow. And I was like, what happened? I was like, oh. The planes crashed in the building today. That's why everybody's here. Everybody's scared. And I loved it. I was like, I wish we had more disasters. You might think, Bill, you're whacked. No, I'm not whacked. I'm like saying, finally, people got it. But as soon as that drifted away, passed away, nobody went to the prayer meeting. The same people went to the prayer meeting, we would go to the prayer meeting. Why? Things hadn't changed. So they were all upset and fearful, and they couldn't even, it's like they didn't have enough of the word of God to understand what's going on. God's sovereign over the nations. I'm not concerned about these disasters. I know God's working in this nation and other nations. I know God's sovereign over everything. He's sovereign over my life. What am I worried about? All I'm worried about is doing his will. That's the only thing I fear. I don't fear China. I don't fear Russia. I don't fear North Korea. I don't fear anybody. I don't fear the Philadelphia Eagles. But you should fear the Patriots. Now, I don't fear any of that because God's in control. I'm not afraid of nuclear weapons. Okay, so I'm not afraid of dying. I mean, I could walk out of here and die. Why am I not afraid? Word of God says, those who believe in Jesus Christ, when they die, they're absent from the body, face to face with the Lord. That's what the Word of God says. I'm giving you application of God's Word, the benefit of it. There are people who you know these people at work, you have people in your family, and they don't know how to handle anything. They don't have any resources to handle their problems. They fall apart. Or they use alcohol or booze or sex or something to take their mind off stuff. Music, whatever. Just not that there's anything wrong with music, but they can't handle life. It's too painful. Life is too scary. They don't have nothing to face it. God didn't design his creatures, human beings, create them in the image of his image without any help. He designed us to run on his word. To live according to his word, that's what he wants. Just like a car needs gas, so the human soul needs God's word. We were designed to have God's word in our heads. But the devil would like to feed you something else other than God's word, a counterfeit and lies. And the lies are all around us. So I'm saying these things because God, if he's running the nations with his word, we've seen that clearly in Jeremiah and Obadiah with the fulfillment of prophecy. We've seen it in Zephaniah. We've seen it in Daniel. We've seen it all over the Old Testament and the New Testament. If that's the case, I think he can run our lives with his word. I think he can solve our problems with his word. It's just a case of whether you're going to give him the chance. So Jeremiah 25, verses 15 through 38, we studied. We just read a few moments ago. Lists many nations existing in his day and age which would experience God's wrath. And several of these nations took part in the Babylonian-led invasion of Judah in 586 B.C. The prophecies in verse 16 of Obadiah obviously are not only directed against these Gentile nations, but also Edom, because she aided the Babylonian-led coalition against Judah, as we noted in verses 10 through 14. Nebuchadnezzar's Babylon was able to capture the city of Petra, capital city of Edom, and take the citizens of Edom into captivity, just like he did the kingdom of Judah. And Arabian tribes moved into that location where Edom previously occupied during the 6th century B.C., which forced those who had survived among the Edomites to migrate west. They became a province of the Persian Empire and were no longer a national entity. They were ultimately reduced by John Hyrcanus of the Maccabean dynasty in Judah and lost their national existence under the Romans. They were cut off forever as a nation, though the land would again be populated. So what I'm telling you is history records for us the prophecy of Obadiah, verse 16 verses, fulfilled literally in history. Where's Edom today, people? Here's another thing it tells us. God is judge. He's sovereign. He's in control of the nations. President Trump is his servant. Yes, that's right. Well, the premier of China, Putin, they're all servants of the Lord Jesus Christ. My Bible says that. Romans 13 says, civil authorities of the various nations of the earth are Jesus Christ's servants, like Nebuchadnezzar, whether they know it or not. What does that tell us? God's control and he's sovereign over the nations. No need to fear anything. God's got it under control. What are we supposed to do? Obey our civil authorities. If they tell us not to do, if they tell us to worship an idol, like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in Daniel 3, we say no, because God says no idolatry. And then if they tell us not to preach the gospel, as in Acts 5 with the apostles, we preach the gospels, and if they throw us in jail, fine. Those are two instances of justified civil disobedience. If they tell us to kill Jewish baby boys, like Pharaoh told the Hebrew midwives, you say no. Yeah, I mean, you say, yeah, we did it, lie, and save the boys. That's justified civil disobedience. That's right. I mean, it's common sense. But we don't have that in this country. So we pray for our leaders. We obey our leaders. They need prayer. You don't like the leader? Pray. Civil authorities, local authorities, governments, pray for them all. National, federal, state and local level governments, pray for them all. Don't complain. Complain. That's what it says in 1 Timothy chapter 2, so that you can live a tranquil and quiet life. Christians that don't pray for their leaders because they don't have the same political persuasion as they do are fools. They reject the word of God. They're fools. Because God's word says, you're a fool. I say, pray, he says, and they say, no, I know better than you, God. Ridiculous. But we get Christians like that all over the place. Again, there's another example that they don't believe God's word. They want to believe the political. They'll listen to Fox News before they listen to the word of God, some of these people. They'll listen to CNN before they listen to the word of God. Now, the nations, we'll close with this. The nations mentioned in the prophecies of Obadiah 15 and 16 are not referring to the nations which will exist during the 70th week of Daniel, but rather they are referring exclusively to those nations which took part in the Babylonian-led invasion of Judah in 586 BC. These nations would no longer exist as national entities, but a remnant of people from these nations continued to exist. And the reference to Edom in Daniel 11:41, which is a passage describing the activities of Antichrist during the last 3.5 years of the 70th week, is a typo there. It's a reference to Edom that will be come back as a nation, just like Israel did after centuries of not being a nation. So we'll see. We'll close with this, but we'll say this: Edom shows up in Daniel 11:41. Edom shows up in Daniel 11:41. And they won't be a nation. They haven't been a nation since the destruction under Babylon. Babylon destroying them. Eventually, they're going to be a nation again, according to Daniel 11:41, during the tribulation period. We'll see that they'll be destroyed by Jesus Christ. In fact, there's a passage in Isaiah 63 that says, the people go up to Jesus and say, where are the blood on your garments from? And that he had come from Bozrah, which was where Edom was. And so Edom, Daniel 11:41 says Edom will be around as a nation during the 70th week. So Christ will destroy those people at his second advent when he establishes his millennial reign. So again, verses 15 and 16 of Obadiah were fulfilled, are speaking of the nations that attacked Judah in the 6th century BC, and that's the nations he's talking about. And of course, this foreshadows what God's going to do during the tribulation period against those nations that attack Israel, led by Antichrist. Well, you've been a great audience, and thank you for your patience on some of the interpretive issues here this morning. So let's close in prayer. Father, we thank you for this time to study your word. We pray that this lesson would be a blessing to the body of Christ. Guide them in the application of what they've learned here this morning. We pray that it would be an encouragement to them, as this prophecy was an encouragement to the remnant of Judah in Babylon centuries ago. So, Father, we pray for this in our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ's name. Amen. All right, we're going to take up our Sunday morning offering. Okay, the song I want to do is The Word. And that's on page 166. All right, let's pray. Let's pray for the offering. Father, we pray that this offering will be given with proper motivation and the power of the Spirit in obedience to Galatians 6:6. That those who are taught the word of God are to share all good things with those who teach them. We pray that this offering would be, taking part in this offering would be a blessing to your people, because your son taught it's more blessed to give than to receive. We pray that it also produce many thanksgiving in myself, the recipient. And we just pray, Father, we thank you, Father, for those you raised up that are being faithful with the treasure, the finances that you have given to them. We thank you for each and every person and all those who are serving and praying for this ministry as well. In our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Dismissed.